one of the key things these audience of ours have suggested is to depoliticize our security agencies, starting with the police. A key recommendation that I've heard from our audience to us is to give the IGP security of tenure, that's one. Even take away the power of appointment from the executive and put it in a sort of a commission of other security or people qualified, neutral people, or people other than political class. One of the key things these audience of ours have suggested is to depoliticize our security agencies, starting with the police. A key recommendation that I've heard from our audience to us is to give the IGP security of tenure, that's one. Even take away the power of appointment from the executive and put it in a sort of a commission of other security or people qualified, neutral people, people other than political class to make that appointment. I have also heard from our audience a recommendation that even the post of an IGP, just like we have in the lower ranks of the police where promotions are based on the exam, an assessment, should be one that people so qualified should apply for, and a competitive process used to select the very best. That is one. For the group of audience who recognize that we're almost at the point where it appears the horse is already bolted from the stable, which is that the vigilante groups are already with us, they suggest, one, the political parties must be made, and there's a lot of talk about this, and you get a sense from our audience that they're fed up with the mere talk and no action. The political parties must be made, compelled either by law, to immediately disband these groups. Not only disband the groups, disarm the groups. Because I've heard members of the audience who listen to Joy FM or the Joy News on television say to us that if you only disband, we know that some of these individuals are armed. What do they do with the arms they have if you only disband? There must be a deliberate process to disarm them, either through an amnesty system, which we've tried in the North before, where guns were washed in the North. We provide an amnesty. People can bring their guns, either for a reward. The state is buying back the guns. That's one suggestion I've heard from some of my audience, as in how that can happen. And there's another layer of suggestion I've heard, which is how do you deal with the fundamental mistrust that mainly parties in opposition have for the state institutions, because they feel the institution is politicized. There must be another suggestion I've heard is to deliberately come up with a strategy that builds bridges between the police and the political parties on a regular basis. You can have a regular forum where they interact. They have direct access to the system, the police system, just as the incumbent party would. And if it's agreed that the man at the top is not appointed by the political class, but by a neutral system of peers or another body not political, that then could be a confidence-boosting measure. That's another suggestion I have heard from some of our listeners who have participated in some of the shows that we've done on this subject and will continue to do. Before the elections, we had planned, and on the day we deployed a total of 3 reporters to cover the by-election. And they were asked to go around the polling stations. I mean, there were more than 100 polling stations. It's impossible to have a man in each polling station. So in essence, they move around from polling station to polling station, and also had built contacts. If something was happening somewhere, you get a call and then you rush there so that you can get the live, up-to-date coverage for our listeners. In essence, that's what election coverage comes down to.
Now, there's been reports of certain incidents during the election. Did your men cover any of the incidents?
Yes, my lord. The incident that we are aware of is, which has become very topical because my domain is the media, is the Labawalishi incident. And that incident, yes, we had a man on the ground who covered it for us. Yes, my lord.
Did your man file any report with regards to the incident?
Yes, my lord. My man on the ground filed detailed reports. John uses both radio and TV. We are also online with myjohnonline.com. And so the reports were filed on all these three platforms, primarily through television, which then is piped onto radio. And obviously, the printout, the write-up, it subsequently goes onto my journal line. So yes, our reports on the ground did file reports from the Labawalishi incident.
Now, did your reporters report on any other incident apart from Labawalishi?
So apart from the Labawalishi one, which took a lot of the coverage, and as we all know, it dominated the coverage of the by-elections, although it was in one place in Bawalishi. We also generally covered voter turnout, the conduct of the polls generally. We spoke to the election officers who were manning the various polling stations. We spoke to the police. We spoke to voters who had turned out to vote. We also spoke to political actors, as in those who were monitoring the polls. We also spoke to the leadership of the various political parties on the day. And so there's a wide range of things that we did apart from the Labawalishi, but admittedly, and the way news works, the...
So that was Evan Spencer speaking at the IRC West Commission of Inquiry sitting yesterday. Evans himself is with us in studio this morning. Good morning, Evans.
Good morning, Daniel.
Great work, by the way, yesterday.
Thank you very much.
Awesome. It really represented us well. And of course, there's Shem, who called into the show yesterday, and he gave some very, very interesting perspectives on the matter. So we brought him in to studio to continue the conversation. Shem, thanks so much for joining us.
Daniel, good morning, and thank you very much for having me.
Of course. Shem, like I said earlier, is a retired military man. And Malik Abbas Dabo, usual suspect here on the show. Good morning, Malik.
Good morning again, Daniel.
Good, good. So Malik is joining us because there is some specific insights on some of the issues we've been sharing that we have to continue with today. We would go back. Okay, let me just set the stage for what we're about to do today. One of the main issues that has been raised since yesterday was how people are taken into our security services, because the independence of our security agencies is key. So questions have been raised about why the IGP doesn't seem independent, senior police officials can't seem to prosecute these political vigilantes. Why is it that they're sort of subservient to the politicians? And then an offshoot of that is, how do they become police officers in the first place? Because if they go in there with an allegiance to one politician or the other, we would have a problem with their loyalty. Now, Shem gave us some perspective yesterday, and Shem would be sharing that again, giving us more insight and more suggestions into that. And of course, Evans was also there yesterday. He will be speaking to us now. Before we begin this particular discussion, let's hear DCOP Patrick Ejuse Sapong. He is the Accra Region Police Commander. This is what he had to say yesterday.
DCOP, there is also this perception that politicians in opposition do not trust the police. Have you heard?
Yeah, that is true.
And according to them, the police service is at the whims and caprices of the government of the day. Have you heard that?
Yes, that is why when in government, they trust. Because when they are not in government, they don't trust.
Why do you think when they are in government, they trust? And when they are not, they do not?
The fact is, when they are in government, they have certain influence over the police. So when out of government, they don't have it, they become afraid and apprehensive that the powers that they use when they were in power and had, they also be used against them. So they are afraid of their own shadow.
What do you think, with your experience, as a country, we can do to take off the influence the politician in power has over our police service?
In my personal view, as SAPON, but not speaking as a policeman.
Very well.
Politicians should do politics and allow security men to do security work. I don't know how possible and how feasible that would be. So if the politicians take themselves off security and allow the security men to do their own work without any letter of hindrance, then I think with time, if it is to be sustained, everything will be well.
Independence of security. This issue keeps coming up again and again and again. And those are the thoughts of DCOP Patrick Eduse Esapong. He's the Accra Region Police Commander. Let's now hear Professor Henrietta Mensah-Bontu. She, of course, is a member of the commission, and she had this to say to the media.
When the British demobilized the West Africa Frontier Force, they took them into the services, police, prisons, I believe even the army. They were largely illiterate, but they had been to war and they knew how to fire guns and stuff like that. They created the escort class within their forces, and everybody knew that these people were not going to rise to be IGP because the qualifications that the police require can't be met by these people who enjoy stature and power when their parties are in power. And so I was thinking, as part of the public consultation and sensitization that your work enables you to do, perhaps you might want to take up the angle of real integration and rehabilitation, so that when you criminalize the formation of such groups, you wouldn't have criminalized a means of income for people who otherwise have no other means.
Yes, my lord, we commit to do that.
Thank you very much. And while shining your light, could you shine it from the angle of the people who derive stature from these people? Because whatever you do, if they are able to wear something called a uniform and can boast of being even on duty, you'd be surprised the things that people take pride in. We might want to investigate from their angle so that we can have a national conversation on what to do with them to take them off. But as for being malicious, they are. And we shouldn't use nice euphemisms like political vigilantism. They are private militias. And the danger is that, as you pointed out, these rival groups are beginning to fight within the parties, which means that they answer to political particular leaders. That makes the leaders warlords. And this is warlordism that, if not checked, can degenerate. So let's have a holistic conversation, helped along by your resources, so that we can all live in peace in a country that respects democracy. When we democratized, we were looking at state institutions and so on. We didn't look at the ordinary person who has been through colonialism, authoritarianism, military governmentism, semi-military governmentism, and have become used to being ordered about, used to being beaten on the head by anybody who wears anything that looks like a uniform. Can we begin to de-traumatize the Ghanaian and let Ghanaians insist on their rights? Once upon a time in the United States, I was on a train, and a military guy, obviously going home on leave, joined the train. I was the only one nervous. I kept looking over my shoulder at this soldier, because he was dressed in uniform. Everybody else ignored him. It took a while before I realized I was nervous because I was a Ghanaian. And in Ghana, when you see a soldier, you react. Everybody else ignored him. So perhaps we need to work on the national psyche, that those days are behind us. And so we should not just accept anything. Then people putting hapless, unemployed, unemployable young men into uniform to cause commotion might think twice. So I believe you can help a lot in the detoxifying the Ghanaian mind. And I encourage you to do it. And thank you for all the educative programs you mount.
So that's Henrietta, Professor Henrietta Mensah-Bonsu. She had this to say to the media, and Evans, she made a suggestion to you,
yeah. And
you don't agree with that suggestion anymore, even though yesterday you seemed to agree. You changed your mind about that. I'll come to you to get your thoughts on that. But the former IGB, Patrick Kwatin Echampon, who is also a member of the commission, also had this to say. We'll listen to him, and then we'll come back to studio.
All the evils that you can think of arising out of the police institutions, it's worse under our national security systems in Africa. But people don't study the national security structure. They are indifferent. And then we have allowed those who are lucky to be working in those institutions to think that the laws do not apply to them. When the constitution says, I don't know whether you're not too young. Do you remember when, during the Champions time, the police could keep you for 30 days?
I have read about it, my lord.
And when the constitution was being drawn up and people were making arguments, the police said, you can't do investigations in 48 hours and this and that. It's not in the constitution and nothing has happened. Nobody has died, you see. But you still have national security apparatuses in Africa. They keep people for, and you have the BNI or whatever it is, and their clients are there for 3-4 days and they are virtually begging. They don't go to court to enforce the rights of their clients, because when they go to court, unfortunately, also all are brought on the judiciary. They have the national security apparatus to defeat the purposes of the law. So it has become a norm that if somebody wants to disturb your human rights, they go to national security or thrown into some cell somewhere. And civil society does not discuss these things. So please, let us look at the laws governing national security and the structure and operations of our national security system. We've all been burdened with a group that is wearing uniforms, and that has caused much of the problem at Labawalehi. And so most of the talk is about what did the police do, where were the police, where were that. The group that caused it, very few of us are discussing them. So please, let's take a look at the national security structure. Then my last point is about, again, the electoral process. The chairman was asking about whether the military should take part in. I have always held the view that we should develop systems, our electoral system, how to make the police and the military or whoever it is irrelevant or very, very irrelevant. If we can develop a system for re-registration, the electoral register, if we can really develop a system for re-registering our people such that at the end of it, most people will think and have confidence that this is a credible register. And then if we can develop the voting system, and there are so many examples to choose from, such that once you go there and you punch something, can the position disturb, you punch and it reflects that the district electoral office, the regional electoral office, and in Accra. What then will be the use of the police? Much more the vigilantes. But it is because we still cling to the old system that started in 92. We amend a few things here and there. And so all the time, we all don't trust ourselves. And so we want to form illegal groups. To say, when I hear that word, I get mad. To monitor the election, to protect our people, to protect. So please, let us use our imagination. Ghanaians have wonderful imagination. There are brilliant Ghanaians all over the world. We don't even need any other people from any other country. We can call on the expertise and the experience of Ghanaians in this country and outside. And let us develop an electoral regime that largely removes the interference or the intervention or the authority of the security forces in our electoral process.
So that is former IGP Patrick Kwating Ichampong. He's a commissioner or a commission member for the IOSU West Wagon by-election commission. It's still live on the Super Morning Show on Joy 99.7 FM. It's 11 minutes past 8. I'm Daniel Dazi. With me in the studio is Evans Menta, head of politics here, or head of the political desk here at Joy News. He's also host of Top Story on News Night and PM Express on Joy News on TV. Shem is a retired military man, and Malik Abbas Damo is Evans's deputy as the political desk. He's editor of myjoyonline.com. Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
Good morning, Daniel.
Okay, so I'll take initial thoughts from you guys before we take our first break. Evans, I'm starting with you because you had a specific point of departure from the point you stated yesterday when Madam Henrietta Mensah-Bonsu made the point to you that we can integrate some of these groups into our security services.
I think the first point I'll make about that is I think one of the biggest takeaways for me, I think one of the biggest positives is the conversation. I think the fundamental point the both Justice Short and Henrietta Mensah-Bonsu made is that we should begin to think beyond just the call for disbanding and disarming the vigilante groups. Of course, I now hesitate to use the word because, and again, I agree with them, that they are private militias. Because vigilantes tend to have a sense of a positive
Like we describe,
agenda or objective.
Like we describe Martin Amidou as citizen vigilante.
Yes. And I think it's true. I mean, if you really watch the modus operandi and what they do, I mean, with somebody now dead in Kumasi, allegedly because of at the hands of some of these groups, they are private militias. But I think the biggest thing they did yesterday was to suggest to us that in the conversations, and it's been dominated by the calls by civil society and all of us that we should disband and disarm. But the I'm yet to hear a proper conversation about, assuming we get there, assuming we succeed in disbanding, what do we do with these individuals? And I think that's a big next step that the commission is nudging us all to start to debate, and which is a good thing, so that we can have a holistic approach to dealing with this. That's my first point. The second point is the question you asked, and it was Justice Short who began the suggestion to me. Who put the suggestion to me about what do I think we should do to these individuals if we succeed in disbanding them? And his suggestion was, don't I think it's a better option to sort of integrate them into, you know, existing services, etc., as far as the state is concerned. And my initial position to him was, I disagree with that position, and I explain why, because I thought it's going to in essence perpetuate the cycle, because fundamentally the parties believe that whoever is in power, I said to him that the integration is already happening, because the MPP comes to power, we know they integrate. They are people that they work with in opposition as their private security. NDC comes to power, the allegation is that they also do same. In Ayawaso West Wagon, we've heard NDC tell us that they've spotted some of these guys who they've been told are national security guys, who they knew from before. And so that is what breeds the mistrust. And so if you're integrating them, that then sort of then it perpetuates that. But when Professor Henrietta Mensah-Bonsu also jumped on that suggestion, she then drew my attention to how this has worked in other jurisdictions on the continent, which is true, and how these post-conflict individuals who were armed, who had probably been fighting on both sides, had been integrated into the services and giving something to do, and it has worked in those jurisdictions. And then I agreed with her because, yes, it's worked elsewhere. But also something she fundamentally said, which also I agreed to, was that she introduced the element of, if you're going to integrate, it has to be across board. So NDC vigilantes, MPP vigilantes, and whichever political party there is who has this group, you provide a level playing field for everybody else to come in, and then you create that system from there. But having thought about it again, because I then went back to look at the examples she cited, which is the Liberia.
There was Rwanda.
Exactly.
There was Liberia.
Exactly. I think that those examples aren't exactly the same as what we are talking about here.
Okay.
Because those were post-conflict, almost failed state security solutions. We cannot apply that to a normal functioning democracy like ours. Ours is a normal functioning democracy. We are not anywhere close to those scenarios, those examples that I initially agreed to, because there's the fundamental difference there. Ours is a functioning democracy. The security agencies still function, and they should be in a position to rein these individuals in at this point. But it does so leave the big question: if I disagree with that position, what is my alternative? And I think that's where our mind should go. If you disagree, whoever is listening and disagrees with Harriet Mensah Moses' position, what is your alternative? I think that's the biggest thing they are nudging us to do, to collectively have a conversation where, as a country, we come to a consensus on what we do to these individuals if we succeed in disbanding and disarming them. And I think that's what, and I have a few suggestions that is spinning around my head that I guess we can all begin to have a conversation around.
And that's why we brought you here, Evans, this morning, because we want to begin this conversation on that track of, okay, beyond disbanding, what can be done? However, Shem, one key thing that Evans mentioned was the existence of a functioning security system that we have. We have various agencies here in the country. They work. They have the capacity to crack down on these people. However, you have some questions about the state of these agencies as they are now.
Yes, Danny. We would obviously have questions because in every institution in Ghana, we have politics playing a very large role. To an extent, and the security services are no exceptions to the rule. It applies. Even in the military, you have maybe known yourselves, you're not supposed to talk about politics per se, but you definitely know this person is inclined to this party more than this party. So then there's a bit of, you know, tussle and bustle between yourselves, but then it's not known to the top hierarchy. So I believe it's more of something that we know pertains to all the services, but something can be done about it. Because yesterday, me calling in, I made comments about the way the recruitment process is sometimes done, where scenarios of maybe a protocol list or you not having to see somebody at enlistment stage and then seeing the person at the end of the day at training grounds, it's like, where from you?
How does that play out when they finally come into the military?
Because the person might not have been passion-driven, and maybe the person is party faithful or whom you know, the person joins the service without that passion. So the person somewhat becomes, on a scale to 10, the person becomes maybe a 5, whilst the others could have been probably 8. So you realize such persons do not carry that zeal, that passion for the work and to be able to do it wholeheartedly. A soldier is supposed to give yourself wholeheartedly to whatever course or whatever function you are being called to do. So if, let's say, you came and then you saw it as a source of remuneration, income, you are just here because this person placed you here, I believe it really diminishes the output of a security service or the security man or whatever work you can be able to do.
When I come back to you, I want to find out how it was like being on the same team with some of these guys, because we know that military has to do a lot with trust and teamwork and you having to make sure that this person has your back. How that plays out in a normal working day, something that I really want to hear about. But let me also give Malik the opportunity for his opening comments. And we have been having this conversation for days, but this point about beyond disbanding, what?
And that takes me to where Evans tailed off and his disagreement with the integration of these persons into the regular structure of the security services. I think it is a dangerous proposition. And this is why. Already you have these people who have taken entrenched positions politically. And you know that, regrettably, it appears there is a certain democratization and legitimization of violence in this country. And these two groups are the persons who are the greatest purveyors of the violence. Now, we know they are poorly trained. We know they are poorly remunerated. We know they are poorly armed. When you integrate them into the mainstream systems and you give them better training, and you give them better equipment and you give them better remuneration, you may not be able to, by merely integrating them, take away the primary motivation of being politically aligned. Now, all the parties tell us that these guys are recruited and trained to do what? To monitor and protect the ballot. Now, when you integrate them, would you have eliminated that desire to monitor the ballot on behalf of their political party? The answer is no. Their political party will still have an interest in winning an election. And because our elections are a zero-sum game, the competition will still remain keen. Now you have police officers in uniform who have arms and who have a duty to protect the ballot on behalf of their party. So you are going to have police officers turn on each other, or police officers turn on ordinary citizens in furtherance of their party's objectives. I do not for once believe that if you are NDC or MPP, you are incapable of doing your job and excelling at it. I think what we have to do is to desensitize the Ghanaians' belief that politics is a zero-sum game.
Mm.
And we have to eliminate that tendency for people to suffer unduly when their party or a party they have leanings to loses power. In many parts of the world, it is immaterial to a person's personal well-being whether or not their party is in power. In Ghana, it means everything for many, millions in fact, for their party to be in power.
Mm. Malik, very interesting element of that conversation, because in Ghana, I mean, in 2016, I was in Takoradi working as a journalist. There's a neighborhood in Takoradi called Ifeokuma. The public toilet in Ifeokuma was affected by President Akufo-Addo's win in Accra. The one who sits at the public toilet and takes 50 pesos or 10 pesos from people entering was changed as a result of the change in government, or a change in power. And that is how much... that's how much the points you are making hits home. So it's 23 minutes, nearly 24 minutes past 8. And when we come back, I think the conversation has really been situated well by the members of the Commission of Inquiry and by those of us in studio, that we need to take the conversation beyond merely disbanding and look at what can possibly be done after that. Because this is still a group of young men who are possibly armed, I can say definitely armed, and who have a set of skills that can be used to their benefit or otherwise when it comes to keeping people safe. So what can we do? And then what is stopping us from getting to the point of disbanding in the first place? Your comments are welcome on 0244-340-437. Tweet at us at Joy997FM. Go on our Facebook page, Joy99.7FM. We'll take a few messages and we'll come back. But your text messages are brought to you by Afrodan. Your back must last you a lifetime. Glyco Travel Insurance Policy. We cushion you for life. Afrodan is offering you today the most comfortable chair in the world, the Nightingale Extreme Comfort Chair. It has over 10 thoughtfully engineered features, especially customized for your health and comfort. So go to Afrodan on the first floor of the Swansea Shopping Arcade and feel this chair. You will be amazed. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
It's music's biggest night at the 2019 Stanbic Jazz and Music Festival, featuring Salif Keita, Richard Buna, and UK UK's biggest reggae and pop band, UB40, featuring Ali and Astro. It's three big nights at the Plush Labadi Beach Hotel Beachfront and the Fantasy Dome Trade Fair Center. Roll back the years. Bring back the nostalgia of yesteryears. Make a date on Thursday, 28 February and Friday, 1st March 2019 at the Labadi Beach Hotel Beachfront. And on Saturday, 2nd March, the grand finale comes off at the Fantasy Dome, Stan Big Jazz, in partnership with Labadi Beach Hotel. For ticket reservation, call 0205-050-054 or visit www.jazz.stanbigbank.com.gh. Stan Big Bank, moving forward.
Hello, I say, how did you know? Vodafone normal 10 megabyte free data. It will call smart crew biadren.
Hello, have you heard that Vodafone is giving 10 megabyte free data for every minute you talk? You just dial 50-50.
Yeah, hello. Right now, we the Vodafone people just they call plenty. Sake of us, you talk 1 minute, you go get 10 megabytes. You talk 2 minutes, you go get 20 megabytes. 3 minutes.
Call Vodafone or any network and get 10 megabytes of free data every minute you talk. It's simple. Talk to browse. The more you talk, the more data you get. Dial 50-50 to subscribe. Talk more, browse more. Terms and conditions apply.
The future is exciting. Ready?
The world is changing. The rules are changing. Industries are changing. But you know what's not changing? Smart Ghanaian entrepreneurs and business owners who are seizing the day and making new waves. An idea can change your life. That's why Forbes 8 is dedicated to sharing content that celebrates the passion of innovators while creating a networking hub that connects you with local and global business leaders. Learn from the best. Learn from their mistakes. Learn how they overcame challenges with content covering over 100 topics and industries. Join Forbes 8, powered by Busy. Sign up today with your Busy Forbes 8 bundle or visit www.busy.com.gh/Forbes8 for more information. Discover your greatest self with Forbes 8.
Hey, Kweku, what is this? Can't you see? My fresh new Tier rubber Hyundai with stylish leather seats, steering audio control, Bluetooth to receive all calls whilst cruising. See, I can even park with a rear view mirror camera. Simple. One button, one touch, then vroom. No key. You see how the SED blow? Sweat be what? And all for about 63 Ghana cedis a day.
Hey, Charlie, brand new Hyundai. About 63 Ghana cedis. Bakweku, how?
Masa, my bank society Jana Ghana. Charlie, all you have to do is to go to the Hyundai showroom. Choose the car you want, and SG Ghana Bank will give 100% of the funds you need to buy it. It's so simple. You get up to 60 stress-free months to pay back, and the interest rate they be.
Hey, SG Ghana Bank. Yeah. Bakweku, can I test drive it?
Sir, test drive. Go get yours, chief test driver. Yes, you too for Tier Rubber in your brand new Hyundai. Get full financing for the car of your dreams at the best interest rate on the market today with SG Ghana Bank. Call 0302-214-314 or visit any SG Ghana Bank branch right now. And remember, terms and conditions apply. With SG Ghana Bank, the future is you.
My dear, getting a new asset will make me feel on top of the world. Look, I'm thinking of getting a new car, a house, an acre of land, and a new draft for the business.
No doubt, my darling. But why not first check to ensure the security of these assets before you buy?
Ah, you are right. With some people using their assets to take loans from different banks, while others sell properties which do not belong to them to innocent buyers, you and I have no choice but to quickly fall on the collateral registry to know the true status of any property we want to buy or accept as collateral for loan.
You better act now.
Don't lose guard. The Collateral Registry of the Bank of Ghana is the one-stop place for banks and individuals to check the true state of an asset. Contact the Bank of Ghana's Collateral Registry at the City House 11th floor or call 0243-543-931.
Collateral Registry, securing your transaction.
This message was brought to you by the World Bank Group and IFC in partnership with the Bank of Ghana and with support from the State Secretariat for Economic Affairs, SECO.
Coffee in your cup and joy on the set. The Super Morning Show is always the best bet on Joy 99.7 FM.
Okay, so we have called them vigilantes. A new name has come for them, political militia. But if Bob Marley were alive today, I'm sure he would call them crazy bald heads. Chase those crazy bumpers. Oh, Evans, you disagree with the Bob Marley analogy?
Yeah, I'm saying that those who own these political militia groups, they are the crazy ball heads.
And so we should chase those people out of town.
We need to chase those owners of the political militia groups out of town. And these are the top politicians, those with money to spare. And it turns out, if you look at it, these are taxpayers' funds as well. Because if you really genuinely earned money, genuinely sweated, toil and blood, made money, you will not spend it on such frivolous venture.
Here comes the con man. Well, a lot of people contribute in different ways to political ventures. But then again, you would ask yourself, is it an investment? What do they stand to gain?
Yeah.
When even if they is their own money, when they invest such money, what do they stand to gain? So please, a happy birthday to you, Yusuf Tiyuntaba Abu of Hillview Montessori School. You turned 4 years old today. This is from your mom, Zulaiha of Jifek. But so the song is not for you, Yusuf. The song is not for you, please. The song is for a different reason. And it's also to you, Mrs. Mavis Chumesi Mensah. A happy, 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 happy birthday to you. You are the head of DHL Kumasi. From your staff and from our very good friend Irene Daze, she calls you a boss, a friend, a mom, a sis, and all in all, you're a true leader, not just a manager. Happy birthday. Let me come back to the studio now. So, Evans Malik has raised another element of this. People who sponsor them, what could be their motivation? But you see, there's an idea of we need to invest in politics and get something out of it, isn't it? I've spoken to people myself who tell me all the time that, oh, since I entered politics, I haven't gotten anything out of it. It's the same wealth that I came into politics that I still have after 10 or so years. There's this idea of it's an investment I should get out of, Malik.
Well, it's because we have relaxed the rules. And because we have relaxed the rules, people make money that they ought not to make. Imagine, have you not heard people in government or people within the parties fight over contracts? Why will somebody who has no experience in construction, all of a sudden, because their party is in power, they are into construction? And sometimes they actually fight over the contracts, and the fights actually spill into the media. And yet these people have no experience. They've never done any construction. They probably never had any interest in the business of construction. As soon as their party comes to power, all of them become contractors. And they either take the contracts and execute them themselves, or they take the contracts and subcontract them. In the terminology they use is sell it. They sell the contracts.
Yeah, and I've seen that happen so many times. Mm.
And make the money. Mm-hmm. Now, when you make that kind of, that's not money you have earned. So it is the reason the contracts are padded, the jobs done is shoddy. Because everybody is cutting corners to make money that they do not earn or do not deserve. Now, when you have that amount of money, what do you do to stay relevant within the party? So everybody's attention is on elections, because it is the elections that bring the party into power.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do you influence the elections in a manner which will benefit the party? Either you secure the elections, or you get more people to vote for the party. Getting more people to vote for the party is difficult for many. So the best thing to do is secure the elections. And how do you secure the elections? Get a group of young unemployed people, and to use Professor Henry Temesa Bonsu's expression, unemployable people. Give them money, instigate them, brainwash them, and then parade them as people whose main core duty is to police the ballot.
Mm.
Because the politicians have mistrust for themselves. If people who seek our mandate to lead can, and they do this, collect young minors and take them to election centers to register them as voters. And they do this without coercion. That these people who are seeking to lead us themselves on their own volition can pick people who are under voting age in clear breach of the law, and they go and send them to registration centers and register them to vote. And the parties don't deny this.
Mm-hmm.
Both parties, both of the major parties, they don't deny this. Mm-hmm. They concede. They concede it in the media that they do this.
Mm-hmm.
They get people who should not ordinarily vote to vote for them. That engenders the mistrust. And an answer to that mistrust is, well, then you have to be on the lookout. So gather these people, train them, arm them, so that they can police the ballot and protect your interests so that you win the election.
And a few things. as we have this conversation about, so you disband, you disarm, what next? I think we need to emphasize also that it's good to have that conversation, but we should make a separation. Before we do that, those who actually have committed crimes, you cannot do anything about.
You can't ignore.
You can't say we need to integrate them. That conversation we can't have. Those who've committed crimes, punish them according to law.
Mm-hmm.
Fish them out, punish them, prosecute, jail, whatever. Do that severely. Those who have not but are part of these groups, armed, let's have a conversation about what do we do with them if we disband them. Now, we all know that one key reason why, and I said it at the commission yesterday, that these groups thrive is because, and Malik also touched on it, these young men are mostly unemployed. The politician feels that the devil finds something for the idle hand to do. So give them something, keep them sustained, and use them for your purposes. Now, as we begin to interrogate and have a national conversation about what do we do with them if we succeed in disbanding, some have had disagreements with the suggestion that integrate them. However, I think we can find a great example in what we did with the Stop Galamsey campaign, right?
And even when they bring back our tardy girls.
The thing about the Stop Galamsey campaign, when government decided to do this, the media civil society helped. There was a second conversation about, so what do we do if we succeed in getting these Galamsey guys off these concessions and from the forest? And so what government did was to draw up this multilateral integrated mining project.
Uh-huh.
Part of which, a huge plank of that, was to create alternative livelihoods for these people. Now, I'm just reading some of the things they did was to bring in private companies who provided seedlings, and they give the seedlings to the Galamsey guys. They started planting the seedlings and creating sort of plantations, etc., afforestation, reclamation, but also another leg was to put them in classrooms and give them skills.
On skills, proper mining.
Yes. Skills, not necessarily in mining, but in tailoring, carpentry, so that you give them some capital. They can then go and set up their own businesses, whatever it is, that they become employable. I'm saying that is an example we can use in the conversation about what happens after you disband.
Mm.
In other words, and listen, one of the big things I think we can credit the commission with, even before it finished its work, is that it sparked a fire in the belly of civil society, in the belly of media, to do something about this political militia groups that we are talking about. And as you see the conversation evolving, and we get to talk about what do we do next, this, I think, is a classic example of what we can do. as I've just cited with the Galamsey conversation,
yeah,
how government approached it. There was a whole
provide
document.
Alternative livelihood.
That is, if
I have
you,
my own that is, problems with this because that, most of the things you are reading now, Evans, have not been implemented.
No, but that's the problem. I mean, part of it.
I mean,
some
so
of them,
that's a separate conversation.
Some of them have been implemented.
Some have.
Some of them, definitely. And we have examples. And I've heard Erasmus reporters from the Central Region of some of these Galamsey guys who are now, and some of them have spoken. Who are now gainfully employed because of the skills they've received as a result of that plan. And my point is, let's scale that up and say, if we're going to do this, we have to think about what we do for these guys if we disarm them, those who have not been engaged in criminality. And I think that is a classic example of how this can work going forward.
Okay.
And this is, I guess, one of the biggest things that you can cite and put up, and commissioners done in terms of the fire in our bellies that they sort of put in there to try and do something about this collective. Now, we need to also do something very quick. This is just 1 second. The commission said yesterday that, and because I made a point, that the reason why the politicians have no political will, because they know they can get away with it. But really, if we think about it, the citizens who vote for them and the term that they fear the most can be used against the politicians. Chase those crazy ball hairs out of town. If we do that at the polls, they will begin to respond.
And this civil was society, position yesterday.
Civil society and ordinary citizens must feel empowered. And Henrietta Mensah-Moser made that point. The media needs to empower the citizens, know that that politician that you so revere, that you almost feel subservient to, you put him there. And that same power can be used to sanction and punish the MPP and the NDC and whip them in line to the point where they are willing to fix the problem of vigilantism. Now, listen to this. When the issue about the Galamsey started, just a second. We knew that there were political elements involved. And for years, none of the political parties were willing to tackle Galamsey. Up until a point where the media and society said, we are fed up. We need to do something and put pressure. We started a campaign, the government joined. Where are we today? We've heard reports about rivers turning brighter.
Yes.
That is the same principle,
even though
we are
not there yet. Very, very great points there. So, Shem, on the point, which is something that you said yesterday, on the point of the role of citizenry, what we must do, I think we were saying earlier here how it looks like there's a certain respect or reverence that we give to politicians in this country. And so we find it difficult to speak truth to power. We find it difficult to demand our rights. Even for to people who demand our rights, people are called disrespectful as a result. Where do you think this comes from? How can we navigate from there?
Danny, I believe it comes from the sheer point that the political parties in Ghana feel they are too powerful for us, the citizenry, to sort of curtail to our needs and some of our basic things that we do. And I feel sometimes it's we, the people, who have made this possible, because we feel we've inclined to certain political parties due to tribe, color, or race. And then we feel like, oh, if this party says this, then I'm A or B. I must be able to fall in line with what the party is saying, even though we know the consequences of whatever we are doing. It's very vague and very shallow. Like, we become so naive that we're only thinking of ourselves. If I vote this party in power, I get this next. If I do this, I'm having this reward. And I believe it's so shallow for a Ghanaian who is the most, you know, powerful person, for you to think a political party which you placed in power is just charading you in town, doing whatever they please, and we sit down and watch. So I believe it's us, the people. It's us, the people, if we can hold these two parties, major parties, accountable for some of these things they've done over the years. And now it's gotten to a point where, for some of us, me, I can say for myself, I don't think I would ever put a thumb there for these two, because what they've done cannot go unpunished. And we need to punish them at the polls. We need to, as Ghanaians.
But you see, Shem, when you limit it to these two parties, I begin to ask myself that if it was any other political party with the same resources and with the same means, would they do anything different? That, I mean, beyond the principle of teaching a lesson, if it was any other political, would they do any different?
Well, it's a two-sided sword. It cuts here and it cuts here.
Two-edged sword.
Yeah, it can be good and it can be bad. But I believe the media has also paraded these two political parties in our face for so long a time. It's taken the public sort of a long time to decide, oh, I think we must try this guy. I think we must try this party. Even though we know some of them are inclined to the major political parties, I believe we, the populace, can stand up and say, hey, we are fed up with the two of you coming to power, not really doing what we want you to do, doing what you please. The next 4 years, listen to this. How do you lose elections? The next day, you are an opposition and you start campaigning to come to power. You don't take time to reflect. What did I do wrong? What did we do wrong for the people? What do the people want? And here is the case where the next few months, I'm coming back to power. I wonder, what again are you coming to do? We voted you out for a reason. Have you thought about why you were voted out of power?
Well, that comes down to their strategy. But Malik, this interesting question of how we as a people react to these politicians. Because in the end, a lot of responsibility and onus is being placed on us as citizens. The way we practice our democracy in this country, it's like it's reduced to the election. We vote, we go to bed for 4 years, and then we come back and vote.
You know, it's often said that people get the leaders they deserve. Yes. And I think to a very large extent, it is true. Otherwise, politicians are very rational people. They will not do anything which will not inure to their benefit. And because they are rational human beings, they will do things that they know they can get away with. If the politician can get away with murder, they will commit murder and they will get away with it. Fundamental truth is we have failed as a people to hold each other, first of all, accountable and to hold our leaders accountable. You and I sit here. When sometimes you ask politicians questions or you question something they say, and the people will call and say, why are you talking as if you are smarter than the politician? As if anyone has said that they are smarter. There is a certain presumption that once a person is in a position of authority, the person is all-knowing and the person's everything the person says or does is sacrosanct, can't be questioned. That's opinion for many. But for me, I think that one fundamental thing that we have to do to stop all of this, and Evans was talking about dealing with the criminal aspects of the conduct, I think that is where this country has failed big time. Enforcement of our laws.
Which is where this texter speaks of, you didn't add your name to it. He says, fine discussion this morning. However, we are silent about the judiciary bit of this. Take the Delta Force cases in court and how they were made to go free by the same courts they attacked. Do you believe the judge just made them go because they did nothing wrong? Or powers that be made sure the judge lets them off? We truly have a banana republic and a rotten system. Okay, so a point of fact there is that they were punished, but it feels like a slap in the wrist because they were in the end punished for rioting. They were fined and they were made to sign a bond or something. So it's the opinion of many, like, you know, this was, they were let off easy. Let me use that expression. Malik, this seems to reflect a bit of what you're
saying. Yesterday I said on TV that when Michael Flynn, who was national security advisor to Donald Trump, was brought to court and accused of lying to the FBI, the judge looked him in the eye and said, you are a disgrace to your country. And that is a crime. He lied to the FBI. It's so frowned upon that the judge looked him in the eye and said, you are a disgrace to your country. And if you know Michael Flynn's track record in the military in the US and what he has done, and yet by lying to the FBI, because he was in touch with Russians and he said he wasn't, and the FBI said he had lied, they brought him to court. That's what the judge told him. I said that we need courageous police officers. That's all we need. All of these things happen because all of us together, civil society, private individuals, journalists, teachers, parents, everybody, chiefs, opinion leaders, the clergy, all of us have worked together to cripple the police and render the police redundant.
Okay.
In this country, it is fairly common for somebody to be arrested, for the pastor to go and beg, for if the person is a journalist, for the editor to call the police commander and beg, if and for the imam to go and beg,
mm-hmm.
For the politician to go and order. That's how it works. The others go and beg. The politician, they order. They order that the person should be released.
So they have the most opportunity.
So,
but we all do it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So we hold the law in abeyance, and we build a society in which people can commit crimes and not be punished for it. So obstruction of justice is utterly allowed, permitted, is permissible, is practiced. When in other jurisdictions, any attempt to obstruct justice costs you legal troubles. And because of that, nobody dares interfere with the process of the application of the law. Mm.
Malik, one person who agrees with you very strongly is Kobna Tabedu, procurement specialist, procurement expert who often appears on the show. He says, at the heart of the problem is a lack of trust for the police. Punishing them won't change a thing. Depoliticizing recruitment into the security system is the key, and ensuring their independence is a start. You also sent me this one. It says, good morning, Dan. Malik is right about the distrust among the politicians, but the greatest challenge is the dishonesty of our politicians and lack of respect for the citizens. Augustus sent us this one. So many of your messages coming in. I want to dedicate the next 5 minutes or so to reading as many of them as I can. Evans's submission says, Evans, you were reflecting a lot of what you've heard from listeners.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so when you hear in the submission, you say, yeah, this is what we have picked from the public. Those crazy ballads out of town. And by the approval that I kept seeing on social media, it looks like you were indeed reflecting the views of the public. But Yabwedu sends this one. He says, I do not think these guys should be integrated into the military or the police. The politicians should manage their own monsters. The integration of these people into the security forces explains the reason why we have police or soldiers committing armed robbery. Papayal says, I strongly believe that the police administration in particular have hidden behind politicians to underperform. You'll agree with me that political recruitments have taken place in other security agencies, but the level of indiscipline in the police administration is unmatched. Is it because it's lower in other agencies, or with the police we meet them more? Yeah, because you see, the one security agency that interfaces the most with the public is the police.
Yeah.
The immigration does not interface as much. For the military, is almost not at all. Almost non-existent. So maybe, Papayao, you may want to consider the thoughts. And Shem here agrees with me. He's a former military person. JC from Tema says, Shem's statements are very educative. And indeed, truth be told, the situation confirms the negative trend leading to possible disintegration or deterioration of the Ghana Armed Forces. The politicians causing the scenario remain mute while the rot goes on. Makosby Anthony sent a long one. He says, Daniel, I don't agree with this integration of vigilante groups into our security system. Why are we trying to legalize an illegality? The groups are already a criminal group with loyalty to a political party and funded by them. Why not threaten all political parties to lose their status if they continue to fuel these groups? If they integrate them, the next person too will form a group, cause mayhem, and be expected to be integrated. Please, let's get serious. Change the constitution now. Criminalize and prosecute all these criminal groups. Separate our security administration and make it truly independent. Please, enough is enough. You go on to say, I voted for the MPP. I am unemployed and therefore have been for more than 8 years now. Wow. I look at policies and not parties. Come on. Then all of us will go up in arms to be integrated as well. Please, good morning, Makosby Anthony, with that one. Makosby, it's already illegal. So I'm reading from Section 200A of the Criminal Offences Act 29, inserted by Section 5 of the Criminal Offences Amendment Act 2012. So this amendment was made in 2012 at 849. It says, organized criminal group, a person who participates in an activity of an organized criminal group, commits an offense and is liable on conviction to a maximum penalty of death and to a minimum penalty if of not less than 5 years imprisonment. It goes on to define an organized criminal group. It says, is a structured group acting in concert with the aim of committing a serious offense. So for instance, if you organize yourselves and you go and rob, organize yourselves and go and attack a polling station, whatever you organize yourself to do, that is not according to the law. For the purposes of this, a serious offense means an offense for which the maximum penalty is death. A minimum penalty is imprisonment for a period of not less than 5 years. Okay, so it's just defining the legal terms.
But then I just want to ask this question.
Ask.
So MPP has vigilante groups
militia,
political militia.
And their purpose is to what? Protect the ballot, right? The NDC also has DS, and their purpose is to protect the ballot. Who are these groups protecting the ballot from?
From each other.
From each other. That's a great answer there, by Shem. Okay. I'm going to take this batch of messages, and when we come back, we'll hear from Kofi. Now, Kofi Badwimba called the show yesterday. Kofi Badwimba is a member of the MPP, and he feels that... Oh, did he say? Yes. He mentioned MPP. And he feels that when his government comes to power, he must benefit personally. Yeah, he must benefit personally.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll listen to the reasoning behind that mindset, because this clientelism really is the heart of this vigilante issue or this militia issue, right? All right.
Yeah. You know, we're all getting used to the new term.
Yes.
And I've just been checking. No, vigilantism was good. Now, but I also realized that there's militialism.
Militialism.
Right? Yeah.
Militialism. Thanks.
Yeah? So,
Charlie,
so
that's why we love Evers, isn't it?
So we can use it. It's nice.
Yes.
I mean, but no, it's not nice. It's actually... It
suits the purpose.
It brings a criminality of it to the fore.
Mm.
And the parties have been playing with it because we've nicified the thing. It's, you know, vigilantism.
Yeah, because
it's a sexy word. This is a criminal, powerfully bloody word. So when you hear it, you know. So I have a militia. Then you probably hit you that this is something.
So
that you
what, invisible
have.
Forces is a militia.
It's some, of course.
Delta Forces is a militia.
It's a militia.
Which is the other one? Azoka Boys
and this
boys.
Is the kicker. And this is the kicker from Henrietta Mensah-Bonsu. Those who control them are warlords.
They are warlords.
So there are warlords in the MPP. There are warlords in the NDC. And yesterday, I'm told there's an interview that somebody granted in Kumasi saying that he admitted he owned...
Joseph Yamin.
Yes.
The Hawks.
Yeah. He owned the Hawks. He is a warlord.
He said, what is wrong?
He is a warlord. And the police should do something about that. They're not just... They might admit and let him walk.
Exactly.
When a group that he owns... It allegedly has shot somebody and killed a person.
Okay, we take the Joy Business Minutes now, and we'll take these important messages. When we come back, like I said earlier, we'll hear from someone who believes that when his political party comes to power, he must benefit whatever happens, and we'll discuss that a bit further. Stay with us. This is a Super Morning Show.
Welcome to the Joy Business Minute.
Daryl and Karen, hello.
Renowned economist Dr. Joe Abe says a city's depreciation is more of a challenge with government expenditure and revenue than dollar supply. His argument is a sharp departure from what we have been made to understand is causing the city to fall.
It appears the current pressure on the local currency would not end soon. This morning, the dollar is likely to be sold to you at about 5 cedis 40 pesos. The British pound has also crossed the 7 cedi mark.
The incoming chief executive of Vodafone Ghana, Patricia Obunai, says she plans to continue with strategies that would help position the telco as a key challenger in the market. She becomes the first Ghanaian boss of Vodafone Ghana, effective April 1.
And Ford has said it will close a factory in Brazil after more than 50 years as it stops selling heavy commercial trucks in South America. The U.S. carmaker said it saw no viable path to profitability.
Tough times for the automobile industry.
Tell me about it.
At Afrodan, we believe that many of the problems people have with their health is as a result of the way they sit. In other words, your chair can kill you. Here's Dr. Marcus Mann of the Chiropractic and Wellness Center.
What you have to remember is that the spine is the lifeline to your body, and posture is the window to that spine. Now, posture is affected by your daily activities and habits like sitting. That's why at the Chiropractic and Wellness Centers, we recommend what I believe to be the best chairs available for preventing not only subluxations, but also other health problems that you may not be aware of, and that's Rabani and Mobilex chairs. Unfortunately, on a daily basis, I have to correct the effects of this poor sitting habit in our businessmen and businesswomen. Always remember, optimal spine equals optimum health.
So, for the sake of your health, buy Rabami or Mobilex chairs from Afrodan. We are on the first floor of the Swansea Shopping Arcade. Telephone 663-085.
Oh. And you know, my claim is not covered by the insurance policy I arranged.
Pakwesi. I've always advised you to let J&J Insurance Brokers, the insurance professional, handle your insurance to avoid gaps. At J&J, we analyze your insurance needs, we arrange cover with the best insurer with a track record of prompt claims payment, and above all, we facilitate and negotiate your claims. Call Dr. Gideon Amenyedo, the CEO, on 0244-333-335 or 0504-333-335. You can also email him, Gideon@jnginsurancebrokers.com, or visit our website, jnginsurancebrokers.com.
Thank you very much, Eyunam. I'm calling doctor right away.
At J&J Insurance Brokers, negotiating a great insurance deal is our business.
Global Communities invites you to take part in the official Yedia Project Training Registration Fair. It's implemented by the Global Communities, formerly CHF International. Among the technical trades offered for the 6 months training include electricals, tiling, masonry, metal fabrication.
We also have 3 weeks entrepreneurship skills training in financial literacy, life skills, and business planning.
So if you're between the ages of 17 to 24, unemployed, currently out of school, and interested in registering for training, please come to
the premises of Atinko Media Village
on Wednesday,
20th February 2019
at 8 a.m. prompt. Bring an ID. It could be voters, national health insurance, or birth certificate. We look forward to your attendance. This advert is brought to you by the Global Communities in partnership with Opportunity Industrialization Center, Ghana, Artisans Association of Ghana, African Aurora Business Network, Ghana Real Estate Developers Association, and Association of Ghana Industries Construction Center.
If you buy gold, you will save money. Because gold lasts longer. If you paint your house gold, it will shine brighter. Because gold withstands all the elements. And gold protects you from microbial growth. And it's washable. And contrary to common belief, gold comes in every color your heart desires. So, invest in gold premium acrylic paints the next time you want to paint your house. Highly washable, long-lasting, with a wide range of products from acrylic paints to enamels, primers, stuccos, and more. All engineered to the highest international standards. Protect your home. Invest in gold.
Now is the time to discover more Europe. Turkish Airlines Fly Festival has begun. Book your ticket between January 20th and March 31st, or between May 1st and May 30th, and fly with Turkish Airlines special fares. Terms and conditions apply. For detailed information, please visit turkishairlines.com. Turkish Airlines, widen your world.
Now, this very moment, it's the pulse of possibility, potential, power. It's time
to make your move.
To take that step.
The time
is now.
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 The great things you do tomorrow start with the small steps you take right now. So take that step with Old Mutual. Call us on 0302-230-638 and make now count. Old Mutual. Do great things every day.
No great story ever begun with, and we stayed at home all day and did nothing. Adventure, that's where great stories are born. Adventure has enough room for friends. It's spacious. Adventure happens in the city and out in the rough. Adventure has your back, front, side and side. Adventure is affordable and available. Ignite your own adventure with the all-new Renault Duster. With a new sleek design, comfortable drive, 360-degree multi-view camera, hill descent control system, a 1.6-liter efficient and powerful engine, and so much more. Adventure. The all-new Renault Duster is sold in service by Premier Motors Limited. Call 0307-079977 or visit the Renault showroom at Atiko Junction on the Kanishi Odoko Road.
Renault, passion for life.
My name is Daniel Dazzy here in the studio with Evans Mensah, host of Top Story and News Night, Joy News Editor, Head of Political Desk. Malik Abbas, double usual suspect here on the show. He's editor of myjoyonline.com, deputy head of the Political Desk. And Shem is a listener, retired military man, concerned Ghanaian. Some of your messages coming in so far. Kweku from Accra says, Daniel, what's the difference between an armed robber who goes about robbing and killing people and an armed political militia who goes about killing political opponents? Are we also going to integrate armed robbers into security agencies, create jobs in the economy so these political activists can get regular jobs and earn regular livelihood? The reason so many young people risk their lives to follow visionless politicians is because they don't have jobs. Dan, protocol lists in recruitment is real. The most qualified are left out while novices are recruited and now begin to learn basic things they should have known before joining the army. God save us, concerned listener, with that one. The main problem is political interference in recruitment into our security services. People who bought scratch cards, went through body selection, wrote entrance exam, and even paid for their own medical examination, which was conducted as a police hospital, are still sitting in the house. And as now, people are just called and issued with appointment letters and asked to report at the training schools for training. For me, the commission missed a fine opportunity to tell us what happened at Ayawaso West Wogon from the viewpoint of the media in their encounter with Evans Mensah. Well, to you there, they have invited Roland Walker as well. They have requested the presence of Roland Walker.
Yes.
Who was there? Actually, Roland is the one who broke the news.
Yes.
This on this show. Yeah. And on the AM show as well. So he'll be going to tell us what he saw on the ground. You add this, I thought they would ask questions from the video and photo evidence he supplied. That's Evans supplied, but rather they thought it's wise to ask his opinions on some issues.
But also the videos are very self-evident. I mean, yeah, the videos are self-evident. You watch it, it's obvious what it is. You really don't need to ask any further questions. I mean, I guess that's what it really is.
Because they're raw videos.
Yeah, raw videos. Yeah, raw videos. You can look at it and come to a conclusion. Some of them we didn't take ourselves. But the most powerful one, the one with the gunshot sound, that we counted 49 of them, that was given to us by an eyewitness in strict confidence because he didn't want to be identified, called us and gave that to us. And that, I guess, is the most powerful one I've seen yet. It tells
you see so
lot.
Many people running in one direction, in gunshots.
Yeah, gunshots, you see the body parts, etc.
Okay, Abdul sent in this one. He said, Daniel, I agree with Evans. We need to send the owners out of this country. Example, my own father, Sofo Azoka. Thanks, Abdul. Fine discussion this morning. Okay, I've read this one, the judiciary one. T Smiles from Mama Saman says, please, when is the commission inviting Yabuabinya someone to testify? He claimed there was information that the NDC candidates had imported Azoka boys and hawks into the constituency to cause confusion, and that's why those militia men went there. He also claimed the men were shot at by the people in the house. Yes, the leader of the men said they heard gunshots. But I mean, someone must come and explain. So many of your messages. Kojam here in Kumasi says these so-called, well, militia groups now have no legal status. Why then do we talk of disbanding them? We should outlaw them instead. It's already against the law, Section 200A of the Criminal and Other Offences Act. Simple and short, let's do away with party politics. Ghana is not matured for that. Odami Otri of Abeka. Speaking of party politics, I promised you before we went on the break that we would be hearing from Kofi Badjengba. He's a regular caller into the show, I must say. And yesterday when he called, listen to what ensued.
I'm a politician myself. But sometimes, the way our leaders, they conduct themselves, it needs somebody like the media to come out and then make a loud voice. You see, you were talking about people who go and vote for the politicians and they come and demand something from them. And when they refuse to give us our fair share, this results in this shooting and all kind of things. It is sad that you don't have anything. You have your mind on your leaders that, okay, let's do the dirty work for them. When they come to power, they will see to it that you have a good living. At least you have something to eat. and they will come, and when they come, they change their numbers, and even if you call them, they will not respond. You see, and they will lead a good life. And you, the one who did the dirty work, you will see that you are becoming poorer and poorer, and people are laughing at you. Who did party with you? What have you gained? You see?
Kofi, can I ask you a question? Kofi, can I ask you a question?
Ask me, Daniel.
Great. Thanks. When a politician comes to power, is he not supposed to make policies and take care of all Ghanaians as opposed to just his party folk?
Daniel, you have to take care of all Ghanaians, but be mindful of the fact that it took some people to follow you day and night, campaigning, doing everything. Even sometimes they will be sleeping and we will be going around. They'll be sleeping, Kofi, you will not eat.
Kofi, let me ask. Again, because we don't have a lot of time, I just want to engage on this quick issue. When you are spending sleepless nights campaigning for these guys, why do you do it?
We do it because we have our hopes on them, that when they come to power, they make things better. They will make things better. But they will come to power and you realize that you will still be in the condition you find yourself. Sometimes your condition will be deteriorating. Because
shouldn't you be doing this out of a love for our country, rather? Shouldn't you be doing this because you believe the person's policies would help the country? Because you see, Kofi, let me ask you a question. If I was a regular voter and you, the person campaigning for maybe the member of parliament, came to me, would you say, Daniel, vote for Honorable this because he'll make my life better as Kofi Bajimba? Or you say, Daniel, vote for this person because it will benefit you and I as Ghanaians?
You see, I vote for a parliamentary candidate because when I'm in need of something, I can go to him.
But isn't that the heart of the problem we have in Ghana? That there's a group of people in this country who feel that they should be saved before anyone else.
You see, Daniel, these people, you voted for them, they come to power, their children may be sleeping, and you will be doing all sort of works for them, and when they come to power, they will be enjoying with their family, and you will be suffering. Eh? And you are telling me you should think of the nation. Think of the nation. Then the MP or the president that you have voted for, that you have toiled for, should first think of the nation. If he thinks of the nation, by all means, you will also benefit. But they come and they think of themselves.
Okay.
They will put their family members and everything in there. They will be enjoying, and you will be suffering.
Okay, so that was Kofi Bajimba speaking. I respect his honesty and the candidness with which he addressed the issue. And you see, when he ended, he said that, fine, let's say he won't come and benefit me personally. Then he should think of the entire nation so that the entire nation will benefit. And then it will get to me. But he is in the position where he feels it's only the politician's family, so I need to go and join myself to him so that I benefit myself. What do you make of that line of thought?
I believe it's very shallow and very mediocre for an individual who supposedly gets up every morning to say, I want to help such a politician to gain power, and then afterwards you want him to sideline everybody and then focus on you. Yes, you might have helped him. It's kind of true. But did he really require you to help him? You came willingly. So the same way you came willingly to help him, I believe you're supposed to also take a step back. And if he has anything to offer you, he would. But the way you are coming to him, you come to him as if you want him to do something for you at the expense of other Ghanaians. People also voted for him. You did the work. People voted. People put their thumb and gave their assurance for such a person. So you don't just say, he should. Okay, then I also voted for you. How would you validate I voted for you to help me? Mm-hmm. I'll come. People might also come.
Mm-hmm.
I also voted for you. I see you did this for this guy. Why don't you also do the same for me? Come on. Ghanaians must move from that kind of inclination to belong to a certain party due to tribe, color, or race. And let's disalienate ourselves from some of these petty things we need. It's greed. It's sheer greed. And I don't even know the words to choose, but then it's uncalled for.
So generally, it's a very bad thing.
It's a very bad thing.
Evans, how do we fight this mindset? Because you see, we can sit here and speak very nice English, but this is what the real problem is. This clientelism thing, this is where the real issue is.
Yeah.
That it's an investment. I invest my time, I want an appointment, I want money. I invest my money, I want more money back. Where do we go?
Yeah, I mean, but the truth also is that this also happens almost everywhere. I guess the problem with us is that it's just the degree of it. I think ours is permeates too deeply. And we've seen in the US under Trump, people have been questioned for transiting from helping his campaign to becoming lobbyists, who then use that position to now lobby because of their relationship to get deals, etc. So that happens. However, there's something else about us, and this is the people you see elsewhere, the big, you know, contractors, etc., who put money in, right? And they use the leverage on that to get, you know, big contracts. We have that here too. I mean, we've seen in our country a lot of these rich guys who parade around, most of them are politically aligned, and then most of them get their big gigs and wealth because of their political influence that they wield and their political connections. But the bigger problem, because you're talking about political militias, is the foot soldiers, right, who don't have the same level of wealth. And so they also come and support and back, and they do the foot soldierism for you. But they do not have the wealth to get a contract. They don't have the skill to get a contract, a road contract or whatever it is that the big guys get. And they believe what they can get is, you talk about the KVIP. Mm-hmm. Or you have to give me some work to do in terms of providing security for you, which we come back to the political militias. And so these warlords in the party believe, okay, I am in power, I have money to spend, let's keep these guys on, let's pay them and give them that reward that they fought for. And so a few things happen. They either integrate them into the security services, give them the job, because the guy says, I fought for you. I was slapped when I was manning your ballot box or putting your ballot box for you. Now you're in power. Where do you put me? So government creates all these vehicles, NYEP. What's the recent one that they launched? NAPCO.
NAPCO, yeah.
Etc. We all know what that is. It's a vehicle to give job to the boys who have helped us win the elections. I mean, they'll throw in a few neutral guys in there. You know, it's because when you push them, they say, oh, I can point you to somebody who... But we know what happens in there. It's the reason why GDA didn't succeed. It's the reason why the original youth employment program failed. It's the reason why Maslock has been suffering, because these vehicles have become avenues to reward these... How do you call it? Political clientelism. Say it again. No,
political clientelism.
Okay, thank you very much.
Good morning to Papaya Asari. Thank you very much. He's the lead producer.
That is why we create, the politicians create these vehicles. I think the way to tackle it, and that's back to your question, is a difficult one, but we need to start from creating, from the very young age, a sense of volunteerism. Because I covered American politics, elections, and then one of the things I noticed is the young guys who go out there to campaign and knock on doors, they are volunteers.
That's all.
Purely. And most of them are motivated, one, by a policy that affects their lives, two, by their own desire to rise through the ranks to become a senator or whatever it is. And you see it in Obama, who...
So their future ambitions.
Ambitions. Not what I will get if my party comes to power. It's a spirit of volunteerism. And I was in Suyuk. A lot of the guys in my class were either Labour guys in the UK, who they were very aggressive. They would campaign in the school and they don't want anything back. They were using that as a vehicle to sharpen their own political skills. One, because they want to run for SRC. Two, because they believe they can rise to the ranks and they have something to contribute to the society. That spirit of volunteerism isn't in us. Ours is a spirit of, I want to benefit my stomach, pure and simple.
We want to build stomach infrastructure.
Fantastic. You know, and I think at the very basic level, I see that some of the schools now are teaching the kids that go out there, do something for society, because it is, you're volunteering, you're helping somebody, and you can now apply that to say political leadership. I am an MPP person because I'm volunteering. I want to build the skills that one day if I want to become an MP, I can use, which is what I see elsewhere. Right, but here it's different, and I guess that's when possibly we need to start tackling.
It exists here at a certain level. So a lot of I have a lot of mates from KNUSC, for instance, who now work in government, and who work for the their various political parties in some way. And there's TESCON, there's TAIN. But you see, the way politics has become in Ghana, even on the students' front, Malik, a TESCON president is supposed to have money. Like, he is supposed to be someone who is affluent.
A
TAIN president, if you are known as, especially if your group, your party is in power, you are seen as someone who is doing well. You will soon start driving a car.
Because
you
money,
soon start taking people to meetings with known politicians in certain hotels where you come, out smiling. Motivation. Exactly. Now, Enoch sent in this message, which I think dovetails into your point. Good morning, Didi. My question is, what is the work of the NCCE in the country? What education are they giving to us? Let me salute Madam Josephine Nkrumah of the NCC, because this issue of political militialism, which is the word Evans has taught us. This issue of political militia and militialism, they have been talking about it as vigilantism, of course, but they've been talking about this for months, for quite a while. The NCC has been calling out. In fact, a few days before the January 31 IRC Westberg on by election, there was a meeting held by the NCCE where Albert Kandapa was present. Remember, he referred to it during his questioning session. Okay, Malik, Evans has started talking about this building a sense of patriotism among young people, particularly young people. That I see as a long-term future investment. Where do we begin now? Sorry, I'm opening the phone lines. I'm opening the phone lines as Malik speaks. So 0302-216541, 0244-340437. Please call us, let us know what you think. The hashtag is ban party militia now. Go ahead.
I feel, you know, if for the last few months I was out of town, right? This 20-year-old African American guy walked up to me one day and asked me, "Are you Republican or Democrat?" And I didn't know what answer to give him. So I sought to buy time. And I said, "I don't understand." He said, "I mean, are you pro-choice or pro-life?" And then it set me thinking, if a 20-year-old Ghanaian were to ask me the question, what would he say? Because the guy's asking me purely on ideological line.
On the abortion policy.
Are you pro-choice or pro-life? We don't have that. At Meghan and Prince Harry's wedding.
So in Ghana, that you the person should ask you, are you free SHS for all?
Or progressive SHS?
Progressively free SHS.
Progressively free SHS.
Right? But the fantastic point.
And Evans, again, when you listen to the Republicans and the Democrats, all their arguments are about policy. Policy, Obamacare.
Okay, Malik.
What is it?
Malik. Let me ask you to hold on a moment. Remember, we played a sound of Kofi Bajemba. He's called in again this morning. Kofi.
Yes, Daniel, how are you?
I'm blessed. How are you?
I'm fine.
Great. So you have another contribution to make?
Yes, I have another contribution. But first of all, I must commend Evans for his brilliant performance yesterday. In fact, this guy has got a great ideas. And Ghanaians who watch him, he must be the president of Ghana one day. Now, moving forward, Daniel, this call of disbanding the political vigilantism, you see, it is only fair when the political leaders will treat everybody equally. You see, let me use this example. President Akufo-Addo, since he came to power 2017, those MPP guys, the foot soldiers, the communicators, and all those people who fought gallantly for him during the campaign, in the Asante region here, almost all of them, he has put them in a position where they get something small. So, if I am a foot soldier of NDC who is also campaigning for the NDC, I'm expecting that when NDC comes to power, I must also get something as Nana Akufo-Addo has done for his people. And if you come and I don't see that, what do you expect me to do? You see, so if we are talking about this disbandment of this thing, then what I will say is that let's integrate all of them into the security and then make a law that from today going, there's no going to be any political voluntarism or that...
Militialism. Militialism. That's the new word. Thank you very much, Kofi, for calling. Call us. Let us know what you think. What can we as ordinary citizens do to root out political militia? And it looks like this debate is also brewing whether or not these militia members should be integrated into security services. Salifu from Asesewa has called. Perhaps you have an idea yourself. Good morning, Salifu. Thanks for calling.
Good morning, Mr. Dazi.
Yes. So do you think that these guys should be integrated into the security
system? No way.
Why not?
Mr. Dazi.
Yes?
I want you people to pay much attention to what Malik has been speaking of. Our problem here is education. If we're able to educate majority, say about 90 or 80% of our children or youth, they will not go into these so-called armed robbers associations. Look, how can you take a risk as say, if you had gone to university? You don't have gone to join this. Number two, look at the way they dismiss people in the army, the police, and others. What do you want them to do? They will go and join these groups. So let's pay attention to our education. Let's pay attention. In 20 years to come, we will see these things.
Thank you very much, Salifu, for calling us. Dixon is calling from Accra. Good morning, Dixon. Good morning, Dixon.
Good morning.
Great. Let's hear you.
Yes. I think media, you are doing very, very well, marvelously well. What I think we Ghanaians should be educated about is the nature of our politics. You know, Ghana, if you are, most of the times, if you belong to a political party, say, people belong to you till they die, without looking at what they have to offer. So I think the media, beyond what you are doing, I will plead, you just let the Ghanaians understand that before you vote for a political party, find out their ideology, what they mean, what they stand for. The political party today with this idea can change tomorrow. So when its idea changes or its thought changes, then find out which is the best alternative. The moment we begin to think about what they have to offer rather than which party belongs to, it might go a long way to solving this kind of problem.
Right. Thank you very much for calling. Thank you very much for calling, Dixon. Daniel is on the line from Nungwa. Good morning, Daniel.
Yeah, good morning. How are you?
I'm blessed. How are you?
Yeah, I'm good. But for me, you know, I represent freedom of speech. And no matter what, I will still call the Super Money Show. So your Papaya or Sari or Sammy, whoever picks the call, should be aware
Daniel,
of that.
Daniel, make your points call. For me. Now, make your points for
my
me.
My point, well, yeah, I'll make it. But let me speak, because yesterday I was cut off. Well, you just back. You know, for me, I monitor. You know, and I would always be on journalists. This morning, I heard you guys calling, is it Yamin? I'm not a member of NDC, let me state that. You know, but you called him a warlord. No problem, fine, he may be. But I never heard you guys, that's Evans Mensah, I never heard you guys calling, how do you call this guy, Kennedy Ajapon, warlord. When he indicated that he funds Delta Forces and the Invincible Forces, he was never called a warlord. So sometimes, I feel that the media is even not letting people, you know, get the truth. And these militias, because you guys say vigilantes, they are militias. They come about as a result of some of your actions, because sometimes you don't condemn, because it depends on who the person is, which party the person belongs to. And I find that to be unfortunate. Now, these guys, for me, should not be integrated into any force.
Okay.
They should never. The things we are seeing now with the Ghana Police Service and the military, brutalizing people here and there, is as a result of putting disgruntled people in the forces. And if you do that, that will not augur well for the citizenry. Because these guys, even look, they did not even listen to Azu when he was in the video. He was trying to stop them. Those guys dressed like they were going to fight ISIS.
Mm.
Those hoodlums who went to cause chaos at Ayawasu, who were dressed in masks like they were going to fight ISIS. When Azu in the video stopped them, they were passing by. They were not listening to any command. So these guys, I don't know whether they take cocaine or they are marijuana. These guys are not fit for the military or the police. We should never integrate them.
Thank you very much, Daniel, for calling us from Nungwa. We will continue with the phone lines, with the phone calls, but we have to take these messages. So stay with us. When we come back, we'll pick more of your phone calls. Stay with us. This is the Super Morning Show.
Now is the time to discover more Europe. Turkish Airlines Fly Festival has begun. Book your ticket between January 20th and March 31st, or between May 1st and May 30th, and fly with Turkish Airlines special fares. Terms and conditions apply. For detailed information, please visit turkishairlines.com. Turkish Airlines, widen your world.
And welcome to the MTN Weather Report. This year, whatever your needs are, we're there for you. Now, the details of my weather report. 15,000 cities could blow from the extratropical boundaries across the country. We can also see a mist of fog patches of 25,000 cities and a heavy monitory downpour of 30,000 cities to monitor the dry season across the country. Now, ladies and gentlemen, everywhere you go, whether it be school fees or akasisem fees, we're there for you. Rent advance, salary advance, they are sorting advance ninja, because with MTN, we're there for you. Now keep talking, browsing, texting, and sending Momo to accumulate points and win prizes each month to cushion you this year in the MTN More For You promo. 80 dial *120#. Now check your points. We're there for you everywhere you go. Everybody, make us see you do the dance.
I am Dr. Keisha. Acacia gives your workers the best customer service and treatment options when the need arises, keeping them healthier and more productive for your business. Acacia Health Insurance. We place value on those you value.
Since inception, almost 100% of Ashesi University students have found jobs, started businesses, or gone on to graduate school within 6 months of graduation. From Accra to Nairobi, London to New York, Ashesi graduates are noticed and they are leading successful careers. If you dream of a rewarding life and career, an Ashesi education prepares you for just that. Learn more about applying to Ashesi at www.ashesi.edu.gh. Remember, admission is ongoing.
Hello?
Hey, Makai. Hey, you're the everyday Tommy.
Charlie, that be the power of the sound tower. Charlie, hold on, I get a call from other phone top.
Hello?
Issy, you give me 10 minutes and I'm dressing up.
Liar. Dressing up and talking.
But which year are you from if you've not heard of AirPods?
Now that's a gifted man. Gifted by NASCO in the NASCO Mega Gifts promotion. When you buy the NASCO Aleo and Aleo Plus mobile phone, you get a free sound tower, AirPod headset, and free 6 month subscription on Kwese iFlakes. There's more. Buy a NASCO Snap Pro, Power Plus, and Power Plus Pro, and get another phone, AirPod, and selfie stick free. All this and many more in the NASCO Mega Gifts promotion. Visit all Electrolan showrooms and any authorized reseller while stocks last. NASCO, bring home happiness. Terms and conditions apply.
Bring home happiness.
Global Communities invites you to take part in the official Yedia Project Training Registration Fair. It's implemented by the Global Communities, formerly CHF International. Among the technical trades offered for the 6 months training include electricals, tiling, masonry, metal fabrication.
We also have 3 weeks entrepreneurship skills training in financial literacy, life skills, and business planning.
So if you're between the ages of 17 to 24, unemployed, currently out of school, and interested in registering for training, please come to
the premises of Atinko Media Village
on Wednesday,
20th February 2019,
at 8 a.m. prompt. Bring an ID. It could be voters, national health insurance, or birth certificate. We look forward to your attendance. This event is brought to you by the Global Communities in partnership with Opportunity Industrialization Center, Ghana, Artisans Association of Ghana, African Aurora Business Network, Ghana Real Estate Developers Association, and Association of Ghana Industries Construction Center.
If you buy gold, you will save money. Because gold lasts longer.
If you paint your house gold, it will shine brighter. Because gold withstands all the elements. And gold protects you from microbial growth. And it's washable. And contrary to common belief, gold comes in every color your heart desires. So, invest in gold premium acrylic paints the next time you want to paint your house. Highly washable, long-lasting, with a wide range of products from acrylic paints to enamels, primers, stuccos, and more. All engineered to the highest international standards. Protect your home. Invest in gold.
Since I started drinking Glen Tea, anytime water starts boiling in my kettle, Mansa, my neighbor, just shows up.
Neighbor, as soon as I heard your kettle, I knew the time was right for me to come and enjoy your tea.
You know how to work, Papa. As if I knew.
And of course, you know I know how to work. Four cups, right?
Four cups? It's not just you and me.
Oh, no. Two cups for me now. And don't forget Auntie Abebre. So as soon as she hears the sound of your kettle, she'll
there she comes.
What did I tell you?
Introducing new Glen Tea. With its fresh flavor that brings people together. Now available in your neighborhood store. This advert has been vetted and approved by the Food and Drugs Authority.
So you've been listening. It is time for you to speak. 0302-216-541. 0244-340-437. How can we realistically end this political militialism as citizens? And do you agree with the idea that political militia should be integrated into security agencies? Before my next caller comes in, with over 30 years in the stationery business, Kingdom Books and Stationery now offers a 30-day credit facility with no interest charge. Visit us today at Osu Akwaje, University of Ghana campus. Kingdom Books are next near the Accra Sports Stadium, Tema on the main TDC junction, Kumasi on the KNUST campus, Cape Coast on the UCC campus, Takoradi Asfijai near the Teachers Hall. Call 0302-764-101 and 762-307 or visit kingdomgh.com. Kingdom Books and Stationery Limited, your number one stop shop for all office essentials, stationery and furniture. If you are a real super football fan, this is your chance to see your favorite teams go head-to-head live in their home stadia in the UK. Open a Barclays Ultimate account, maintain a balance of at least 500 Ghana cedis, and swipe to make payments with your Barclays card as often as you can to win an all-expenses-paid trip to the UK to watch your favorite teams go head-to-head live. You could also win a stadium experience in our local Superfan penthouse and take away exciting home items and your favorite team souvenirs. Don't miss out on your chance to experience football the way it was meant to be experienced, live with Barclays. Visit our Facebook and Twitter for more information. Terms and conditions apply. Barclays, part of the Absa family. Chediak is on the line from Southla. Good morning, Chediak.
Good morning.
Let's hear you. Do you think we should integrate these groups into security agencies?
First of all, to integrate these groups means you want to get jobs for them to do. The devil finds jobs for the idle hands. What are we doing as a nation to create jobs for the newborns, the already existing ones? Already, what we must get clear is that the consolidated account does not have political color. All of us, our money ends there. And when they use all this money to create infrastructure and things, we leave it to rot. And children, people are in this country, they cannot get work to do. How will they get food to eat and take care of their family? Everything you throw at them they'll go for it. Let's create jobs for our people to save this country.
Thank you very much, Chidiak, for calling us from Southla. Godfred is on the line from Kumasi. Good morning, Godfred. Good morning, Godfred.
Yeah, Danny, good morning.
Great. So what do you think? Do you think that they should be put in the security agencies?
Danny, I am taking a radical departure from what everybody is talking about. I think Ghanaians are not ready for partisan politics. Danny, I was at the Kumasi Sports Stadium in 1978 during a friendly match between the Black Stars of Ghana and the Esperance of La Côte d'Ivoire. Then head of state, General Kutu Echampon, in a speech at that event, sought to espouse his union government idea. We all hooted at him because we thought he wanted to perpetuate the rule of the SMC. We went back to partisan politics. And let's fast forward to the Second Republic. We now have an albatross of MPP, NDC around our necks. When we fought against the union government, we thought we were giving Ghanaians a choice. But we have seen that Ghanaians are not ready for partisan politics.
Okay.
I think we should go back to the union government idea.
Godfred, thanks for calling us from Kumasi. Interesting thoughts there. The question I would ask is, so who heads the union government? Stephen from Osumi, have an answer. Good morning, Stephen.
Yeah, good morning.
Do you think that we should integrate these politicals, these militia men, into the security agencies?
I honestly disagree with this notion that we should integrate them into the forces.
Why?
Because one, before you become a policeman or a military man, even the entry, you have an age limit. Two, you have some kind of a training that you will be, put through before you become a full policeman or a military man. These guys, some of them are even above the ages. And they don't have the required training. So why do we go and put them, into a discipline?
Okay.
So that they also, what are they going to do there?
Great question there, Godfred from Kumasi. Ben from Adenta is our last caller. Good morning, Ben. Good morning, Ben.
Good morning.
Great. Let's hear you. Should these guys be integrated?
I say a big no. Why should they be integrated to come and cause more divisions in the various security services? Because once you get them integrated, they are perpetually, of course, their roots are from the various parties. And so whether you like it or not, they will do things to disintegrate the sitting government, supposing they came in from the opposing party. And they will cause more problems than we are seeking to resolve now. I believe that the law should deal with the situation. The government of the day must stand up and ensure that the people are stopped.
Okay.
And then they are integrated into their own party. If the parties are so minded, they should set up ventures for them where they can get busy. Can the parties go and get lands and do commercial farming and put these guys on it?
Interesting points there, Ben. But does a party exist to set up business? That could be a question we could ask. Okay, it's 30 minutes to the top of the hour. I'll take my last break. When I come back, my guests in studio will wrap up. Stay with us. This is a Super Morning Show.
Now, this very moment, it's the pulse of possibility, potential, power. It's time
to make your move,
to take that step.
The time
is now.
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 The great things you do tomorrow start with the small steps you take right now. So take that step with Old Mutual. Call us on 0302-230-638 and make now count. Old Mutual. Do great things every day.
At Afrodan, we believe that many of the problems people have with their health is as a result of the way they sit. In other words, your chair can kill you. Here's Dr. Marcus Mann of the Chiropractic and Wellness Center.
What you have to remember is that the spine is the lifeline to your body, and posture is the window to that spine. Now, posture is affected by your daily activities and habits like sitting. That's why at the Chiropractic and Wellness Centers, we recommend what I believe to be the best chairs available for preventing not only subluxations, but also other health problems that you may not be aware of, and that's Rabani and Mobilex chairs. Unfortunately, on a daily basis, I have to correct the effects of this poor sitting habit in our businessmen and businesswomen. Always remember, optimal spine equals optimum health.
So, for the sake of your health, buy Rabami or Mobilex chairs from Afrodan. We are on the first floor of the Swansea Shopping Arcade. Telephone 663-085.
I am Dr. Keisha. Acacia gives your workers the best customer service and treatment options when the need arises, keeping them healthier and more productive for your business. Acacia Health Insurance. We place value on those you value.
What are you looking for? Melcom got it all. Great discount, no door. Yamafia saw. Best bargains on our days. Everything here is a bargain. High quality, put me a priority. So tell your mom, tell Poppy, tell your actually everybody.
Everyone says I'm a Kosia filler, but it's not like I'm nosy or go out to find out the latest filler. It's just that I get 50 megabytes of data free after paying for only the first minute of every call. And so I just keep discovering stuff minute after minute. That's how come I was minding my business, scrolling through my timeline, and I found out Coco has a new baby. Oh, and lastly, I learned Ken won the lottery. You see, Ken is my brother's friend. So hello, look who's about to roll with the rich and famous.
Enjoy even more value with MTN Free After One. You only pay for the first minute of your call on MTN Free After One, and the rest is free. Plus, you enjoy free 50 megabytes worth of data to browse your favorite sites. Ope where? Ope ten. So dial *315# to sign up.
We day for you everywhere you go.
Terms and conditions apply.
Oh. And you know, my claim is not covered by the insurance policy I arranged.
Pakwesi, I've always advised you to let J&J Insurance Brokers, the insurance professional, handle your insurance to avoid gaps. At J&J, we analyze your insurance needs, we arrange cover with the best insurer with a track record of prompt claims payment, and above all, we facilitate and negotiate your claims. Call Dr. Gideon Amenyedo, the CEO, on 0244-333-35 or 0504-333-35. You can also email him, Gideon@jnginsurancebrokers.com, or visit our website, jnginsurancebrokers.com.
Thank you very much, Eyunam. I'm calling doctor right away.
At J&J Insurance Brokers, negotiating a great insurance deal is our business.
It's the year of the car owner with Enterprise Insurance.
Hooray!
Just dial *714*556#. Choose update your details. Follow the prompts and voila. You are in for surprises that will make your head swell big. Surprises like mobile data, useful car insurance tips, and many more. Remember, updating your details even helps to speed up the claims process. Car owner, this is your year. Insure with Enterprise. Dial *714*556# and update your details now.
Enterprise, your advantage.
Charlie, that be the power of the cell tower. It dey party. Charlie, hold on, I get call from my phone top.
Hello?
Isi, you give me 10 minutes and I'm dressing up.
Liar. Dressing up and talking.
But which year are you from if you've not heard of airports?
Now that's a gifted man. Gifted by NASCO in the NASCO Mega Gifts promotion. When you buy the NASCO Aleo and Aleo Plus mobile phone, you get a free sound tower, airport headset, and free 6-month subscription on Kwese iFlix. There's more. Buy a NASCO Snap Pro, Power Plus, and Power Plus Pro and get another phone, airport, and selfie stick free. All this and many more in the NASCO Mega Gifts promotion. Visit all Electrolux showrooms and any authorized reseller while stocks last. NASCO, bring home happiness. Terms and conditions apply.
Bring home happiness. Furniture Brefier.
It's nearly time for us to wrap up here on today's Super Morning Show on Joy 99.7 FM. My name is Daniel Dazzy. I'm here in the studio with Evans Mensah. He's, of course, a usual suspect here. Top story host, news night host, head of political desk, Malik Abbas Dabo, editor of myjoyonline.com, and Shem, who is a listener, concerned Ghanaian, retired military man. Before I give the opportunity to my guests to bring us their final words, let me just tell you about DSTV's new plan. You can SMS DSTV to 17331 for a fully installed Zappa HD decoder with 2 months complimentary DSTV access for 199 Ghana cedis. Or you can call 0302-740-540 or 0244-740-540 for more information. Remember, terms and conditions apply. DSTV, feel every moment. Now, J&G Insurance Brokers negotiates a great insurance deal for you. Negotiating a great insurance deal is our business. Call Dr. Gideon Amenyedo, the senior insurance consultant, now on 0244-333-335 or 0504-333-335. Now, UBA has a new discount with love. You have great discounts of up to about 50% or cashback from 5 selected UBA partnered merchants. 50% discount at Silverbird Cinemas. You buy an item worth 1,000 cedis and above and pick items worth 200 Ghana cedis for free at Telefonica. Shop worth 500 Ghana cedis at Bachelor Total and get a minute shopping spree worth 300 Ghana cedis. You also take your loved ones for dinner at Boka Restaurant and get 50 Ghana cedis discount on purchases from 300 Ghana cedis and above, or Imperial Peking, and get a 50 Ghana cedis discount on any sales worth on purchases from 300 cedis and above. Pardon me. It doesn't matter which bank's MasterCard you carry, just use it at any of the 5 locations and get a discount from UBA. The promo ends on the 28th of February 2019. Let me begin. Okay, guys, I can only give you 30 seconds each because we're out of time. Let me begin with Shep.
Okay, I'd like to end off with this saying by Franklin D. Roosevelt. It says, "Let us never forget that the government is ourselves and not an alien power over us. The ultimate rulers of our democracy are not the president, senators, congressmen, and government officials, but the voters of this country. And I must stress this, let's move from our monotonous inclination to belong to a certain party due to tribe, color, or race, and let's get Pension Ghana working again." Thank you, Danny.
Thank you very much, Shem and Evans.
I must also say very quickly that as of right now, Multimedia, we're beginning a campaign, hashtag disband party militias now. Just have it in your mind. Disband party militias now. That's a hashtag. It's a campaign that has been sanctioned by our chiefs that we are starting right now. We ask you to join us because it's going to be a relentless campaign. We're going to there are many aspects of it we're going to flesh out with civil society, etc. And there's going to be marches, you're going to be petitioned, every avenue available to us under the law we will employ to force these politicians to act in not only disbanding and disarming, but thinking about the next step. What do we do with those individuals who have been part of this problem, these militia groups, but most importantly the warlords who control them? So join the campaign, hashtag disband party militias now, and let's bring about some change.
Thank you very much, Evans Mensah, Shem, and Malik Abbas Dabo. The hashtag is disband party militias now. Good morning to our friends at Bros Barbecue. quintessential taste of barbecues, our hallmark. Bro's Barbecue. Tasty, tasty, tasty Lamba. All right. So that's it from us on today's Super Morning Show on Joy 99.7 FM. My name is Daniel Dazzy. Join us tomorrow for another super show. Tomorrow is a State of the Nation address. So expect a lot from your superstation, Joy 99.7 FM. After this, news at on top of the hour will come, and then we will take you back to Osu Castle, where the IRSO West Wagon Commission is sitting. This is your Superstation Joy FM. Have a super day.
Ma, I'm going to the bank to deposit some money. I'll be back soon, okay?
Ah, Kofi, with all that has been going on, are you still going to deposit money at the bank?
Oh, Ma, don't worry at all. I keep all my money at the bank and it's safe. The Bank of Ghana has taken some bold measures to strengthen our banks and protect our money. This will ensure that the banks have more capital to do their business and are better governed so that they can protect the money we entrust to them. Banks will also be able to provide better services to their customers and support more businesses and the economy as a whole.
Wow, Kofi, that is very...